Welcome to the BioBalance HealthCast, episode number 500, how your sympathetic nervous system responds in times of stress and fear. BioBalance Health features conversations about anti-aging medicine. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health, and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor. Dr. Maupin and Brett are the authors of The Secret Female Hormone, the seminal work about testosterone replacement therapy for women, and Got Testosterone, the newly released book for men that helps men choose the most effective and safe form of T replacement. These books are available on Amazon or from Dr. Maupin's office at BioBalance Health in St. Louis and in Kansas City. Dr. Maupin's office is currently accepting new patients. We have in our system what are called defense mechanisms, and they actually come in a category, and they're defined by category in terms of how much energy they take and how much cognitive processing they take. So when you're first born and you don't have a lot of control over your energy or a lot of energy, and you have almost no cognitive processing, what they call the tabula rasa, the blank tablet that has to be written on. And then as you grow and mature, you get more sophisticated in what you're able to do. But the first level of defenses are called the flight or fight defense systems or defense mechanisms. And they are driven by your autonomic nervous system. Mm-hmm. If you make a loud noise or you hear a loud noise that you don't expect to hear and you flinch and you jerk, mm-hmm. your body is immediately going into danger, danger, Will Robinson form.
run.
Yeah.
Hurry.
And it shuts down. Like if you've just eaten a big meal, it shuts off your digestive process. Mm-hmm. That part of your body stops working to digest your food, which mm-hmm. it normally does automatically, mm-hmm. and it shifts all the energy that's taken for digestion into your heart to make it beat faster, mm-hmm. and your lungs to get more oxygen mm-hmm. to your body to maximize your ability to respond to danger.
It sends blood to your brain, to your muscles,
absolutely,
to your heart and your lungs.
And eyes become more acutely focused. All of those things are survival mechanisms mm-hmm. to help you get away from the bear or the saber-toothed tiger or whatever it might have been. Mm-hmm. Same thing happens today. If you're driving along the car and you're kind of lackadaisical and in a daze and listening to the radio, got white line fever, and all of a sudden somebody cuts into your lane, everything surges mm-hmm. for you. You become hyper-focused in a fraction of a second and more quickly able to try to respond to get out of the way to avoid an accident or danger. That's the way our bodies are made. They are meant to protect us that way. Mm-hmm. And over time, we can learn to condition our external response to danger. Mm-hmm. They teach soldiers to do certain things in combat, to follow orders a certain way. No matter if their body is screaming, get the hell out of here. Mm-hmm. They may have to stay in place. They may have to do something. And what they have to do, they are trained to do. And as a physician, Kathy mm-hmm. went through the same thing. If you're in the emergency room and you're operating on somebody and the lights go out or a bomb goes off nearby or somebody in the hallway screams, oh my God, you can't look around and say, what the heck happened? You can't run away with a knife in your hand.
You have to overcome everything you learned as a child. I learned my dad lost his temper when he got mad, and that kind of patterns for you.
Right.
And then my mom freaked out and got worried and all, So my natural response is, oh my God, that kind of response, or to mm-hmm. get mad. When you're in medical school and residency, they completely wipe that out. You can't ever act like that, because that goes around to the room. You have to overcome your internal response, and you have to focus.
Well, if you're doing surgery, you've got an unconscious patient with their chest open or whatever,
right,
that you got your hands in the middle
of. If there's a tornado, you have to close them.
Yeah.
If there's what I went through, a carbon monoxide leak in the room and people are falling down, you have to close the patient. You can't do anything but try to close the patient and get somebody to put oxygen on you so you can do it.
Yeah.
But that is all you can think about. You have to have other people to think about all the other things.
Right.
So
that's why you have a good team.
Right. You have to have a team.
And they're trained for those kinds of things.
Yeah.
As well as for the surgery.
And in surgery.
Right.
You have to have, or OB, you have to have the team. So that's necessary. But what's happening inside is not programmable. I can't change how I feel when that's over. When that's over, my heart's been going at twice its normal rate. My breathing's been, I've been hyperventilating. I've been sweating. I can't stop those reactions to that fear that, oh my God, my patient's not going to live through this because the lights are out, or they're, you know, something's not going right in the room that has nothing to do with me except it's affecting me.
I remember reading, and I don't know, I mean, it's a long memory ago, but I remember reading that Neil Armstrong was chosen from among the original astronauts to be the man who landed on the moon because in life or death situations, they could monitor his heartbeat surged less dramatically than the others. And so they thought the first man in the history of mankind to land on the moon, to be under control of that situation in that critical moment, we want the calmest guy we got.
And, what a
and
guy.
So they picked him. But people can
but
be
normal
trained.
People.
Well, but people can be trained to moderate their response. Mm-hmm. Their body is still going to surge. The system is still going to be trying to scream, danger, danger. But you can control how you perform in the face of it if you are taught how. Mm-hmm. And in less extreme or life critical situations, there are things that you can do to learn to moderate your own response. You may not be able to stop it from surging, but you can limit the extremity of the surge. You can calm it down faster if there are things that you learn to do.
Like, go ahead.
Like deep breathing. You know, mm-hmm. If you can stop yourself and take 10 slow, deep breaths, hold them for a 10 count, exhale slowly. Just do that for 10 breaths. Slow in as full as you can feel your chest, count to 10, slow out. Get it all out, push all of it out.
Because that slows the sympathetic nervous system and
right.
activates the parasympathetic, which slows your heart rate.
And more oxygen in your blood.
Yeah, more oxygen in your blood, and
right.
that slows everything down. But the fact is that the physiologic response was meant to be a short-term response.
Quick burn, boom.
Quick burn.
Like fast twitch muscles.
Right. It's supposed to go and then stop.
Yeah.
And basically, then you were supposed to come down. Where we are in the pandemic and in America with 24-hour news is that we get scary stuff thrown at us all day long, mm-hmm. and we stay in this state.
We get agitated. Our stress rate goes up.
Right. So we're in a sympathetic system, the system that your adrenal is always pouring out adrenaline and cortisol, and we're always, our heart rate goes up. Our cortisol makes us fat. We start eating more. We start gaining fat. A lot of these things get suppressed, like our hormones get suppressed. So we literally get sick after this has gone on for a long period of time.
A lot of people stress eat,
mm-hmm.
and they binge on foods that aren't healthy for them, mm-hmm. but comfort food, sugar, to get some of that, try to relieve or alleviate some of the stress. It
mm-hmm.
doesn't work, but that's what people try to
right.
do.
Right,
and then
they
it
were
creates
taught that.
Additional negatives for their body.
Then, but what I found is that people who have been abused or have been in an abusive relationship for years or who have been in the emergency room or caretakers who are in the emergency room, who were in the ICU, who were in the OBGYN world, they have this chronic stress. They can't get out of this system, and it makes them sick. It often makes them not able to provide the same service they could in terms of taking care of people or to not do those types of professions and to back off and do something calmer like office practice or something that doesn't require the, you know, jump out of bed. And honestly, that's one of the reasons I stopped delivering babies besides the fact that I had found the hormone pellets were needed by my patients. I also developed tachycardia that wouldn't go away. I had a high heart rate even when I slept. And that's really not really good for you.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't get out of that sympathetic system where I was all, my muscles were tight. I was always on guard, ready to jump out of bed anytime the phone rang.
Mm-hmm.
So that damages you. It damages your heart. It damages your adrenal. It damages your tissues. It suppresses your hormonal activities. So basically, you know, I lost hormones earlier. My growth hormone went down at 40 instead of at 60.
You can also develop adrenal fatigue so that your mm-hmm. adrenaline doesn't work anymore.
So you don't have any cortisol.
Glands. Yeah.
Or any adrenaline. So a lot of us who have been in this situation, who have been able to calmly do things, internally weren't able to. We weren't Neil Armstrong. And so we have damaged ourselves. So we actually need to have our hormones replaced, our adrenaline replaced with like Dexedrine or Adderall, because we can't do that anymore. Our adrenal just is worn out.
Right.
So it's a kind of a limited Addison's disease, like Kennedy had. He had no adrenal, so his was had to be given in medicine all the time.
Right.
Just to give him the right hormones, able to deal with stress.
And control his pain and keep him active and functional. And the same thing can happen to you. If you have had some serious trauma, if you've had a number of life-threatening experiences, your system can hyper-respond to that stress, and it exhausts itself and depletes itself internally. So there are things that we would encourage you to work on learning to do, to be aware of, to see if you can learn how to calm that system down. Even if you can't prevent it from being triggered, can you catch your breath? Can you slow your heartbeat? Can you take your pulse? There are things that we know that can help with that. And some of them are very easy to do and anybody can do. I mean, one that we talk about is play soothing music, light some candles, take a bubble bath. If you have a bathtub and you can take a bubble bath, turn on some music, turn out the lights, and lay there in the warm darkness and let yourself just relax. Try to turn your mind off. In therapy, we talk to people about learning to do thought stopping. If you're having a trigger of adrenaline flush because of racing thoughts, you have to learn how, or negative thoughts that are putting you close to a danger signal of some kind. You have to learn how to stop that and just say, I'm not going to think about this, I'm going to think about this. And so then you have to have a preparation. What will you think about instead? Can you focus on memorizing a poem and reciting it, or two or three songs that you like and reciting it? I worked with some music therapists that talked about making a playlist for various moods. And you can make a playlist for working out to get you pumped up and revved up and helps you get the maximum out of your workout. You can make a playlist that's calming and soothing. There are apps that you can put on your phone. Some of them cost a little bit of money, $2 or $3. Some don't cost any, that make sounds that are soothing, nature sounds like crickets or waterfalls or rain, thunderstorms, whatever you can find that works for you. Yoga. Yoga is all about centering, getting calm and getting centered, doing your breathing and stretching. Stretching your muscles will help reduce the stress that your body is feeling. So there are all kinds of things that you can do.
My favorite's massage.
I'm just going to say human touch. Yep.
Yeah, you can massage your partner. They can massage you. You can just even holding hands. I know that we're, but in within a family, holding hands.
Grab a stranger.
Don't grab a stranger. Yeah. Yeah. Those are things that you can do to actually kind of break the cycle. But the one thing that I could do while I was doing surgery, and there were warning signs of something happening outside of my, or would affect my surgery suite, like the lights blink, blah, blah, blah. And that would be, my mantra would be, nothing has happened to me. I should not be afraid because nothing's happened to me yet. So has anything occurred? Like, stock market goes down, everybody freaks, they're in chronic spasm. And I say, well, it didn't, to me, it's my savings account. It of course, it crashed, it divided by half or less or more. And that didn't do anything to me today. That didn't take the food off my table. That didn't keep me from being healthy. It didn't keep me from being loved.
Am I in more danger today?
Right. Yeah. And I'm fine. It didn't touch me. This isn't something that's hit me. Doesn't mean I shouldn't work on doing whatever I can do to make my position better. It just means don't freak over it because nothing's happened. Just like with the virus, with the coronavirus, nothing's happened to me or anyone I know yet.
Right.
So we've all been,
taking reasonable precautions, trying to stay calm.
Wearing masks, wearing gloves, doing everything we can to stay safe. And I don't know anybody who hasn't, thank you God, yet. So I keep saying, it hasn't touched me yet. Doesn't mean it won't. But today I don't have to worry about it right now. And when I have to, I will.
Don't panic now. You can always
panic later.
The other thing that might be worth suggesting, too, is if you can control your thought process, like I was saying, thought stopping, one of the ways to practice that is to try to work a logic puzzle or recite lines of a poem or a play that you may have read, or play card games that require some thought for how to play that, because when you're thinking logically, your mind is not racing wildly, and your body's not going crazy. So if you can find a focus point for logical thinking or for release, you know, like if you paint, if you can paint, that may help you. And I mean a picture, not a wall.
Or a wall. Or,
but possibly
or
a wall.
Or do you want to organize your closets? Or I have a lot of friends
who have been like that
cleaning
do.
Their house, organizing their closets.
And finally, if you are available to have one and open to having one, a dog or a cat can help you calm yourself down, because they are affectionate and loving and responsive. Even when, especially if you're in quarantine for 3 weeks with your wife and you're getting on each other's nerves and snapping at each other, the dog will look at you and say, I'm your buddy, you know, let me, you know, love me. It's helpful. It will help calm you down. So think of these things before you need them. Try to make them available in your repertoire, in your deck of cards to play. I can do this. Practice this, especially the deep breathing, listening to music that soothes. Find whatever it is. Both kinds of music, country and Western, have some songs that are soothing.
Because that's the only kind you listen to. So, well, I think, you know, 80s, 70s, and 80s rock is perfect. So, you know, anything that you want to listen to is great. And on YouTube now, there's a lot of concerts that are being played.
A lot of stars
people are listening.
Doing that.
Are listening.
Things. Yes.
Or just, old concerts, even really old concerts that. Well, you know,
and for the sports addicts, they're replaying old sports games. But you already know the outcome,
yeah,
so you shouldn't
so
get your heart.
That's not nearly
up.
As much fun.
Yeah.
But the last thing I'll suggest is that this is an emotional issue. It's not a logical issue. And when you're in the midst of an emotional issue, the side of your brain that deals with emotions will not let the logical in. And one of the ways to get the emotions down, especially if they're over the top, not they're out of proportion with what's happening to you right now, is to do something logical, is to pay your bills or add up your receipts for your taxes or do something that is just logic, something that you can use that part of your brain, a puzzle, like we do crypto quips, crossword puzzles, things that you use your brain logically for, switches off the emotions and switches on the other side of your brain, which is logic. So that takes away a lot of the burn and a lot of the pain of the emotions. And that would be one thing that I would do to stop feeling as scared or
panicky.
Panicked as
because your system, if it's overstressed for an extended period of time, will break down. These things that we're talking about today will help you regulate and monitor your stress levels, keep you calmer, live longer. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.